Praise the Lord. Welcome to Christ Fellowship Church. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. Guys, you know what the Bible says. You know what Jesus said. He said, wherever two or three are gathered in my name. And we got a lot more than that here today. So we're doing pretty good. Amen. We got to pray for people later. We got a lot of stuff going on. Why don't you stand with me and let's come to the Lord in prayer. I just want to say we had a great time at Knightstown last week, but it's good to be back home. It's good to be back home. So, Lord Jesus, we lift you up. We thank you for this day. We thank you, God, that you're here with us. Lord, just have your way today. Be glorified. We want to lift you up. We want to just give you all of our praise from all of our heart today. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, just have your way in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Greatest day in history. Death is beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. The empty cross, the empty grave. Life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is Jesus is waiting, God so loved the already love, I'm already chosen.
The Bible tells us that we need to speak to one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Sometimes we just get it in our heads that songs are songs, something to be sung. But we really are supposed to speak to one another. To hear the words that, Jireh, you're more than enough. And if you know, when every sparrow falls, how much more do you know when we're going through things? To speak to one another, he's more than enough. When we go through sickness, he's more than enough. When we go through financial problems, he's more than enough. Crying out to God for our loved ones, he's more than enough. And it's only when we're grateful, it's only when we remember what he's done for us and how big he is that we can praise and worship God. Come on, because he's so good, can you say it's well with my soul?
See you.
Thank you, Jesus. Just lift your hands to the Lord. It is well with my soul. Everybody say it. It's well. Maybe you don't feel like it's well, but I'm here to tell you today that you can speak that as a statement of faith today. It is well with my soul. All right. If you're feeling like, man, life's rough right now, I just want you to say it. Just speak it out. It's well. It's well. You, Jesus. He's so good, isn't he? He's so good. You can be seated. Man, can I have Janet and Diana come up, please? We're going to take up this morning's tithes and offerings. These ladies are faithful. They're good servants. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the opportunity to give back to you, Lord. You've done so much for us. You're such a good Father. So, Lord, we pray that as we give with cheerful hearts, that you'll receive our tithes and our offerings and use it mightily in your kingdom right here in Rushville and all around the world, God, in Jesus' name. Amen. How's everybody doing? You doing good? Hey, we're going to do things a little bit differently today. We're going to do prayer at the end of service. So, amen. I'm going to go over a few announcements before we send the kids down for Sunday school. Nikki and I, next week, we get a getaway together alone for the first time in many years, and it's going to be a good thing for us. So we want to ask you guys, pray for us. Pray for us to have a good trip, and pray for us to get the rest that we need and just a good time together as husband and wife. And so because we're going to be gone, that means a couple of things are coming up. Number one, we are not going to be having Bible study for the next 2 weeks. Everybody say no Bible study. For the next 2 weeks, everybody say two. That means 3 weeks from this Wednesday, you better be back here, okay? We're going to have it, right? And it's been good. We've been talking about resurrected dreams. It's been good. So no Bible study for the next 2 weeks. Also, next Sunday, since we're going to be gone for a long weekend, Brother Mark Matthews is going to be preaching, and he's preaching something that's been really close to his heart for years. So I'm excited to hear the recording, and I'm grateful that Dion knows what he's doing back there, and he can fix technical problems. Like last week, we had technical issues, but those guys, they figured it out without me even being here, so that's a blessing. But Mark's going to be here preaching. We need to pray for him because Mark and Tammy have been really sick with this flu that's wrecking people. So, but they're starting to come out of it, and he's still planning and eager to be here to preach the word next week. So that's going to be a good thing. Next week, Mark is going to be preaching, right? What else we got? I'm going to have Nikki come up, and she's going to share a couple of things.
Okay. Operation Christmas Child box collection is going to be here before you know it. November 13th, we're, you know, just over a week away from it being the beginning of November. So I just want to encourage you to pack your boxes and start bringing them back. We've already got 8 or 10 out there, I think. So we're 20% of the way. I can do math, but I'm not good with dates. So we're 20% of the way to our goal. There are still boxes. If you want to pack a box, you can take one, pack it, see the little information board about how to pack your box. When you just hush. I love him. Okay.
We need this trip next week.
Yeah, we're gonna have a good time. Okay. The boxes that are on top of the table are not packed. You are free to take those and pack them. When you finish packing your box, you're going to bring it back. There are labels on the table. You're going to check, is it for a boy or girl, which age group, and then you're going to put your label on your box. Don't take the labels until, like, put the label on when you bring it back. And then if your box is having a hard time staying closed, there are rubber bands out there. Just rubber band it. You can't tape it. Everything gets sorted through. So just want to encourage you not to tape them. Did I miss anything now?
Yeah.
What did I miss? What do you mean? Why? Okay. The person at this point who has brought the most boxes is our sweet little Barb.
All right.
So, Barb packed 6 boxes for boys and girls this year. So, there we go. Anything else that I missed on that? Okay. You guys are noticing there's a lot of pens sitting up here on the altar. Jason's going to tell you a little bit more about that later. This is from our prayer night on Friday night. There are also prayer sheets, I guess you could call it a prayer sheet. From Friday night, I printed out some verses that God has used to build me up, strengthen my faith as we pray and contend for those who are currently walking a different path than choosing the straight and narrow. We'll say that, right? So if you weren't here Friday night and if you weren't here Friday night and you have people that you're praying for, grab one of the sheets. We ran out Friday night, and I apologize to those of you who are here. I did not realize the printer ran out of ink and stopped printing. So we didn't have as many copies as I wanted. So if you didn't get one Friday or you want one today, take it home with you. One verse that's not on there, but I just want to encourage you guys with it because it's on my heart today. It is the goodness of God that leads man to repentance. It's not banging people over the head. Sometimes God does that, and it works. But for the most part, it's our love. So did I forget any announcements?
Good job. Amen. She's a good one, even though she tells me to shut it or whatever. Shush.
She was nice.
Oh, she said hush. That's a little nicer, right? It comes from a heart of love, right? It's a lullaby, right? Okay, yes, if you weren't here Friday, man, it was so powerful. But we'll talk about that a little bit later, more about that. Pastor Bill, you want to talk about worship night coming up in a couple weeks?
I really want to say thanks to our church here for the way that you've supported the worship nights up in Knightstown. The truth is that there's been at least half of the people have been Rushville people, which is really an encouragement to me because it's just the atmosphere is different up there right now. It's getting better. But what you do is you bring hope and you bring stability and you bring a heart for God. So it's been so good. I really appreciate that you've been coming. So the next one is going to be November 6th. It's in 2 weeks, going to be Sunday night. I've got some more of my favorite musicians are going to be there. People that the lead guitar player from my band, Heartstone Crossing, is going to play, and the lead female singer is going to sing too, and then the regular crew is going to be there. So it's been really, really good, and I appreciate you. I don't know what the supper is going to be yet.
Thanksgiving.
It's going to be Thanksgiving. Oh my!
We're eating turkey at the end of the
week. You'll look like me if you eat that. Hey, I just want, yeah, so that's in 2 weeks, and it's been so good. It's been so good that our churches could join together. And also, I just want to stress the Operation Christmas Child, man, she said it, but that's 3 weeks away from today. In 3 weeks, we have to have those boxes, okay? So just be preparing. It's such a good time. If you have kids, it's so fun to pack those boxes with your kids and just teach them that, man, we're blessing somebody who doesn't have as much as we do, right? I mean, the kids can be dismissed for Sunday school. Let's pray for them as they go down. Lord Jesus, we thank you for these children. We pray that you'll bless them, God, and do an amazing work in that classroom, God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Haley, do you remember when you and Shep were like the only two kids in that classroom?
It was me.
Oh, was it you? Oh, it was Vance. That's right. Wow. So you were pretty little then, weren't you, buddy? All right. You guys ready to get to the Word?
Yeah.
Grab your Bibles and turn with me to John chapter 5, verse 5 today. We're actually not going to be in a series today. This is just the one shot right here. But turn in your Bibles to John chapter 5. And what we're going to talk about today is a divine encounter. Everybody say a divine encounter. And I'm going to tell you something really weird about me. Raise your hand if there is absolutely nothing weird about you. Raise your hand. All right. We got a couple, okay? Nobody else is raising your hand. I'm going to tell you something that was weird about me. It's not anymore, but it was for a while, okay? In the mid to late 90s, you guys remember those days, the mid to late 90s? You kids do, don't you? Denver, you remember the mid to late 90s? Yep. In the mid to late 90s, I had this weird thing where I had a love for rest stops. Does anybody love rest stops? You know what I'm talking about on the interstate. You can pull over at a rest stop and stretch your legs and get a drink from the vending machines and go to the restroom and then get back on the road, right? For some reason, I loved rest stops, and it was weird. And when I think back now, it was just so weird, okay, because there was almost like a draw to rest stops. I loved them for some reason, okay? Karen's over here laughing her head off at me right now, and I don't blame her. But here I was toward the end of the 90s, okay, I got off work. I was working in the factory back in those days. And so I got off work on a Friday. And that nighttime, I just had a desire to go on a night drive by myself. Anybody like to go on a night drive by yourself? I'm telling you guys, it's amazing because nobody's looking at you. You're driving in the dark. Nobody's looking at you. It can be you and Jesus. You can think about all your problems and you can just lay it out to the Lord on these night drives, okay? And so I went on this night drive, and I just had an overwhelming compulsion that I wanted to go to the rest stop that was next to Richmond on I-70. Has anybody ever stopped in there before? Okay, yeah. So I'm not crazy because you guys have been there too, all right? Here I am on my night drive, and it was probably about 11 or 11:30 when I left the house to go on this drive, and I just the compulsion that I wanted to go to this specific rest stop by Richmond, and so I drove there. It was about midnight when I got there, and like nobody was around, and I'm thinking, why am I even here? It's midnight. I'm at this rest stop, right? So I get out, stretch my legs, go into the restroom, and nobody's in there, okay? And so I, God, why? Why am I here? Because I'm telling you, I felt a compulsion. It wasn't just that I love rest stops. I felt a compulsion. God, why am I even here? There's nobody even here right now. And so in walks this man, okay? And God says, okay, this is why you're here. And he leads me in to ask this guy, sir, is there any, God has brought me to this place tonight. I know this sounds weird, but I feel like God's brought me to this place. Is there anything that you need prayer for? This man starts breaking down. There's nobody else in this rest stop but me and him. And this man starts breaking down. And he says that my wife and I have been having so much struggles with our marriage. And my life is a mess. And I would love you to pray with me right now. And so right there, the two of us, we just began to pray. And I prayed for him. And I felt that, you know, we could feel the presence of God in that nasty old rest stop. And so this man's heart was touched. He was touched by God. And then all of a sudden, it was over. I left. And let me tell you something. From that point on, I have never, ever had a love for rest stops again. It just left. Let me tell you what happened. I didn't realize what was going on, but that was a divine encounter that God made an appointment for just to touch this man's heart. And it must have been important. I have no idea who this guy was. I probably have never seen him again in my entire life, but I'm telling you that God prepared my heart for years and gave me this love of rest stops so that at that specific time when he needed me to obey him and get on the road and go to that rest stop, that I would be prepared and ready to obey him and go to that rest stop. That's why he did it. I'm convinced, man, because from that time on, I've never felt the same thing again. It was a divine appointment. It was a divine encounter from God where God used me for some reason to touch this man's life. And I have no idea the depths of what was going on, but I just trust that God knows better than I do. Amen. Are you guys with me in John chapter 5, verse 5? Let me set up this story for you because today we're going to talk about another divine encounter. And I'm going to tell you what this story is all about. Okay, back in the days when Jesus walked the earth, Jerusalem was a lot different than it is now. Okay. And so they had a wall around Jerusalem, and on the north side of the wall was what they called there was a gate there, and on the north side of inside the walls there was a pool there called the Pool of Bethesda. Everybody say Bethesda. And so here's the story. This is just a crazy story. I love this story. But the Bible says that this Pool of Bethesda, all the sick and lame people would gather around and just lie there at the pool. And the Bible says that every once in a while, the angel would come down and stir up the waters. And the very first person who would enter into the pool would be miraculously healed. Now, you can imagine with me, right? You can imagine with me the rabble that was gathered around. You can imagine all the sick people that were waiting there in hopes that their time would come. I bet you can even imagine with me all the rushing and fighting to get into the pool before anybody else. I bet that there were people who were more bruised and hurting after this event than they were before they came to be healed. Amen. So here they were waiting by the pool to be healed, waiting for that angel to come and stir up the waters, waiting for their chance. And now we're in John 5, verse 5. It says this, One who was there had been an invalid for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in this condition for a long time, he asked him, "Do you want to get well?" "Sir," the invalid replied, "I have no one to help me into the pool when the water is stirred. While I am trying to get in, someone else goes down ahead of me." Then Jesus said to him, "Get up, pick up your mat, and walk." "Well, Jesus, the water's not even stirred." "Get up, pick up your mat, and walk." At once, the man was cured. He picked up his mat, and he walked. As we get into this story here, I'm going to start with something that may sound like a crazy concept to start with when it comes to this scripture right here, but we're going to talk about the fact that Jesus is the great shepherd. Everybody say the great shepherd. He's the great shepherd. You know, we all know John 3:16, don't we? "For God so loved the world." We sang a song about John 3:16 today. It's probably the most famous and loved scripture of all of them. We know about the Lord's Prayer, don't we? How Jesus said, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. We know these scriptures, but I think one of the top most loved scriptures is probably Psalm 23, right? "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." How many of you are grateful that Jesus is our great shepherd? Amen. He's our great shepherd. Whenever I read a passage in the Bible, I like to pray and I like to ask the Lord, "God, make something stand out to me that I've never noticed before. God, reveal something to me that I've never seen in this passage of Scripture before." How many of you know that the Bible is active? It's living. It's the living Word. Amen. You know what that means? It means that the Bible is never going to change. It's always going to be the same. It's always the Word of God, but we change. We change. Our capacity to receive the depths of God can change. And so that means that you can read the same passage 1,000 times, and every single time you can get a fresh revelation. Every single time you can get a fresh breath from the Holy Spirit when you're reading that scripture, because it's alive. And so I prayed that when I read this scripture, "God, show me something, make something stick out to me that I've never noticed before." And he did. And it's going back to verse 2. Look at verse 2 with me. It says this, the beginning of his story. "Now there is in Jerusalem near the sheep gate a pool, which in Aramaic is called Bethesda, and which is surrounded by 5 covered colonnades." Look at this. I may have noticed this before, but I've never given it any thought before, where it says, "Now there is in Jerusalem near the sheep gate." Everybody say the sheep gate. That's where the pool is. It's near the sheep gate. God, what is the sheep gate? Do you know what the sheep gate is, guys? There's a gate on the north side of Jerusalem. At least there was. I don't know what it's like nowadays, but at least there was when Jesus was there. There's a gate on the north side of the wall of Jerusalem called the sheep gate. Do you know what this gate is? It's the only gate in town where they would lead the sheep through to go to the temple for the sacrifice. Just think about that with me. If you're a sheep and you're going through the sheep gate, it's a one-way entrance because you're not coming back out. If you go through that gate, you're on your way to the altar to give your life, and you're not coming back out of that gate. Amen. Here's the sheep gate. When Nehemiah, we talked about Nehemiah a couple weeks ago, the Knightstown Church is spending a lot of time studying Nehemiah right now because it's all about rebuilding the wall around your city, right? Rebuilding, repairing the breach. And so when Nehemiah brought the captives back from Babylon to rebuild Jerusalem, they began by rebuilding this wall for the protection of the city. And I want you to know that the very first gate that they put back into the wall was the sheep gate. Did you know that? On the north side, that was the first gate that they put into their repaired wall. Why is that? I believe because it was so important for them to get back to the sacrifice, to get back to serving the Lord, to get back to doing the things that God led them to do, right? And so the sheep gate was the first gate they built. There was only one door that the sheep would enter in. And when they entered, like I said, they would never go back out because they were on their way to sacrifice. And that's why I believe it's so beautiful in John 10 when Jesus said, "I'm the shepherd." Do you know what else he said in John 10? He said this. He said, "I'm the door." What's he saying? He's saying, "I'm the sheep gate.
I'm the sheep gate, and if anyone comes in through me, he said, he'll be saved. And this is what he says. He said, if anybody comes in through me, the door, the sheep gate, they'll be saved, and they will go in, and they will go out, and they will find pasture. You want to see something awesome here right now? The actual sheep gate, when they came in, they weren't going back out, but Jesus said, you come in through me, and you're going to come in, and you're going to go back out, and you're going to be saved, and you're going to find pasture. Why? Because he's the great shepherd. Why? Because he's the Lamb of God. He's the perfect sacrifice. This is so beautiful. This is so amazing when you look at it like this. And so we find out in John chapter 5 that the Pool of Bethesda was near the sheep gate. You know what the sheep gate was like? This is the place that everybody say the sheep gate. This is the place. I'm just checking to see if you're still awake. Brother, go ahead. Let's freeze them out. Can you turn on the fans, please? You know what the sheep gate was like? This is the place where only the rednecks would come through with their livestock. That's the purpose of this place. This is where the rednecks would come through with their livestock. I remember a couple of years ago when the pandemic hit and when we were starting to see riots and when America was just going crazy, okay? And even in downtown Indianapolis, you could see the effects of it. Okay, you could go downtown, you could see homeless people all over the place. There was a time when you could see drug deals happening right on the street in broad daylight. And so the city came and said, we don't want to just drive you all out. We want to have compassion on you. But please, can you just stay in this one section of the circle? They were all over the circle. And they said, can you just stay in this one section of the circle instead of all over, okay? We go every Christmas to downtown Indianapolis to look, don't we, Brian? We go down to the circle to see the beautiful Christmas lights and everything. And I remember that year where that you could see it, that one section that they relegated just for the homeless people. Stay over here. You don't have to leave, but stay over here. You know why they did that? Because all the respectable people could still come to the circle and see the lights, and we don't have to deal with that rabble over there. We can stay away from the rabble, leave them over there, and we'll be over on this side looking at the beautiful Christmas lights. Guess what? The Pool of Bethesda was that place. The Pool of Bethesda was the place that they relegated to the outcast of society. This was the place where they threw all the sick and the lame people. You know, I believe the Bible. I believe that the Bible says that the angel would come and stir up the waters and that there were miraculous healings that took place there. But I also believe that maybe all the other respectable people might have played that up a little bit. You know, you guys, you need to go hang out over there. Because if you hang out over there, maybe you'll be healed. And so they all ate it up. They lived there, man. They sat around that pool. Anybody ever heard the phrase out of sight, out of mind? This is that place. The Pool of Bethesda, the place that the respectable people didn't ever have to look at or think about. Let's just send them all over there. Let's just tell them they might be healed and that'll get them to come, right? That's what this place was, the place where the sheep came through, the place where there was refuse, the place where all the outcasts of society would stay all day long. It's the one place in the city where they would be out of the eyesight of all the respectable people, but listen to me today, because this is the one place that the great shepherd wanted to be at that particular time, folks. Out of all the places in the world, the beauty of the temple was right there next to him. And this place where all the outcast was, that was where the great shepherd desired to be at that particular time. Nowhere else would I rather be. I'm talking about the Son of God. I'm talking about the one who sat on the throne. I'm talking about the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. The only place he wanted to be was where them filthy sheep came through. Look up on the screen at one of my favorite passages. It's Philippians 2, starting with verse 5. And today I'm going to read this in the King James because I love how it's worded, at least for this particular circumstance. And it says this. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, Look at verse 7. But made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and he became obedient unto death, even death of a cross. Jesus was here at the sheep gate. And I'm telling you guys that he was the Son of God. He had experienced the greatness of the glory of the throne of God. And here he was making himself of no reputation. And the only place that he wanted to be, the only place that great shepherd wanted to be, was at the sheep gate where his sheep could come in and be saved and go out to pasture. All of that was because he didn't follow the customs of the Pharisees, folks. All of that was because he didn't follow along with the way that the teachers of the law led their lives. He made himself of no reputation. He died on a sinner's cross for us. And because of that, we can go in and we can come out and we can find pasture and we can be saved because he's the great shepherd, because he's the sheep gate. Amen. What I want you to see today is this, folks, wherever you're sitting, wherever you're at in your life, and I want you to grab a hold of this today. What I want you to see today is that no matter how dark your situation is, no matter how despicable or unwanted or unvaluable you feel like you are, Jesus will be there to meet you. It's a divine encounter scheduled just for you. See, Jesus is the great shepherd, and you're one of his sheep, and he'll leave the other 99 just to come running after you if he sees that you're lost, if he sees that you're hurting. How many of you are grateful that Jesus is the great shepherd? Amen. But the key here is this: he's present in the midst of our needs. Everybody say it, present in the midst of our needs. Look at this passage, John chapter 5. The very first question that Jesus asked this man by the pool was this: do you want to get well? Do you want to get well? Now, we may be thinking to ourselves, why in the world would anybody not want to get well? But I'm going to tell you something today. Did you know that there are so many people in this world who are comfortable with their sickness? They're comfortable with their disability. They're comfortable in that position they're in because they know that if that position were to change and they were to become healthy all of a sudden, then their entire life would change, and I just don't know what I would do. I don't know, God, what I do without my disability check every month. I don't know, so don't heal me. Back 11 and a half years ago, you guys know the story that I had surgery because my colon ruptured, okay? And I was lucky to survive that time of my life, okay? But during that time, I'm just being open with you guys. I had an ileostomy bag for about 4 or 5 months, okay, so that the rest of my body could heal. I had that ileostomy. And that's not easy, folks. That's a hard thing to go through. So you know what you have to do? You have to find some kind of a community of other people who experience the same thing. Why? Because you need to get wisdom from other people who've been through this for a while. You need to find out how they do things. So I'm not going to get into all the details, but you need a community when you're going through that, okay? I have compassion for people going through that now. And you know what I found? It was about 5 months later, that I had that ileostomy taken down so that everything could act normal again and I didn't have to have it anymore. You know what I found out when I was in this community? I found out there were many people, not just one person spouting off. There were many people who said, even if I can, I will never have my ileostomy taken down. That's absolutely nuts to me, guys. Why would you want to live that way for the rest of your life? Let me tell you why. Because they said, this is my identity, and I'm not ashamed of who I am. I'm not ashamed that this is who I am now. I'm not ashamed to have this identity. Folks, I don't need that to be a part of my identity, amen? But they held on to it. I've known deaf people who had the opportunity to have a cochlear implant so that they could hear again, and they chose to not get that implant because they didn't want to leave the culture, the deaf culture of their deaf community. Folks, I'm not putting those people down, but what I'm saying today is it was a legit question. Do you want to be made well? What did this man say? He said this. He said, yes. What he didn't say that, but I believe that his heart probably leapt. Yes, Jesus, I want to be healed. Yes, I want to be made well. Yes, I want to, but I can't do it. I can't do it on my own, because every time I try to struggle to that pool, somebody who's better off than I am, somebody who's not even in as bad of shape as I am, they always beat me to it. They always get in the water before I can hobble over there. Jesus, I just can't do it. I have nobody to help me. What the good thing about those words are is those are words that inspire Jesus. When you say, I have nobody to help me, yes, I need somebody to help me. Yes, I want this. Yes, but I've got nobody to. Those are the words that inspire Jesus to kick into action. Because what did he do? He said, pick up your mat and walk. This man here, he was at the pool and he waited in faith. If he didn't have faith, he wouldn't have been there in the first place. If he didn't want to be healed, he wouldn't have been waiting there in the first place, right? But this man, he wasn't capable of doing it on his own. He knew that he needed help, and he didn't realize it, but the helper was standing right there in front of him. Did you know there are so many times when Jesus was present and he healed everybody that was there, but this one specific time, he chose not to heal everybody who was there. He chose only to heal one man, only one man. Why? It's not because his faith was greater than any other person's faith. I believe that was because he knew that he couldn't do it alone. He knew that he needed God. There was a great need for somebody else to come and help him. This whole situation reminds me of the woman who had the issue of blood for 12 years. You remember that story? Issue of blood for 12 years. The Bible says that she went to all the doctors. She paid all her money and nobody could help her. She was out of ideas. She was out of options. And here she was. She found out the healer was coming through and there was a great crowd. And the Bible says that she pushed through that crowd. She didn't care what anybody else thought. I'm going to push through that crowd and nobody's going to keep me from getting to Jesus. This is my last opportunity and I'm going to get to Jesus. There was a great need, folks. There was a great need for something more than what she could obtain on her own. And that need, the answer to that need was right there in front of her. So she ran. And guess what? When Jesus sees a need, he likes to fill that need. Amen. Here's the similarities. The similarities were they both knew they needed somebody else to help them. Here's the difference, though. This woman with the issue of blood, she was running after Jesus. Nobody was going to keep her from Jesus. While this man at the pool had no idea who was standing in front of him, and he wasn't even looking for Jesus. Here's your encouragement today. Whether you're seeking God or not, whether you're running after Jesus or not, Jesus will always be there in the midst of your need. The question is this: do you want to be made well? That's the question. What's your answer? Do you want to be made well? And that leads us to the last point, that Jesus is eternally minded. Everybody say eternally minded. Eternally minded. Well, Pastor Bill, you got us out at 11:15 last week, and I'm already a minute late, so I guess we're in trouble. But it's the last point, though, so we're all right. No, God's still going to move upon you guys today, okay? Eternally minded. Now, guys, Jesus cares about our physical bodies, because when this guy realized that he needed somebody else to help him, Jesus spoke, pick up your mat and walk, and he was healed in his body, and he picked up his mat and he walked, amen? He was healed that day, miraculously healed today. But how many of you know that Jesus is eternally minded and he cares more about our eternal souls than he does even our physical bodies, amen? Because go down to verse 14 and let's see what Jesus says. Later, Jesus found him at the temple and said to him, see, you are well again. Stop sinning or something worse may happen to you. Stop sinning or something worse may happen to you. Do you know what this story reminds me of? It reminds me of the woman who was caught in the act of adultery, right? And everybody wanted to stone her. And Jesus said, he who is without the sin cast the first stone. And everybody left. And he looked at the woman and said, did nobody condemn you? I don't condemn you either. And then what did he say? He said, go and sin no more. Go and sin no more. eternally minded. He's eternally minded. He cares about our eternal souls. Go and sin no more. He speaks to this guy and says, stop sinning, or something worse may happen to you. And I believe with my whole heart that this was just not just a fearful command of God. You'd better stop sinning or else something worse is going to happen. Yeah, that's part of it. But I believe God also speaks grace into us. I believe when Jesus spoke this, how many of you know that God spoke, let there be light, and there was light, amen? And so when Jesus, the Son of God, Jesus, the Word of God, the Bible says the worlds were framed by the Word of God, right? And so when Jesus, the Word of God, speaks, stop sinning, I believe that he's imparting grace and strength into these people so that they can live how God wants them to live. Stop sinning. But here we are again. I said, when I read this passage, let things jump out at me that I've never noticed before. And he said this. He said, on this verse right here, who's the only one without sin? Jesus. Jesus is the only one without sin, right? When Jesus looks at this man and he says, stop sinning, guess what he's saying? He says, it's time to pick up your mat. It's time to walk out of this place. It's time to move from here to a new place. And this is what he's saying. When he says, stop sinning, he's saying, become more like I am. Become more like me. I'm the only one without sin. I want you to become more like me because I've called you to higher places than you just hanging around in this cesspool right here. I've called you to greater things than just hanging around by the fence and trying to look like the world and trying to act like the world and trying to smell like the world and be like the world. I've called you to greater things. You need to stop sinning because I'm here to tell you something today. If you hang around in your sin and sickness, it's going to lead you to a very dark place. Did you know that, guys? 20 years ago, there was a man from Oklahoma who killed his 9-month-old daughter just because she was bothering him while he's playing a video game. Stayed in prison for 20 years. And then this past Thursday, he fulfilled his death penalty and he was executed. And those details, that's not the point of why I'm bringing this up, okay? This is why I'm bringing this up because this is what they said about him in his last time in the prison. They said this. He refused medical attention and ignored personal hygiene. He hoarded food and lived in a darkened cell with almost no communication with staff or fellow prisoners, according to his attorneys. His condition has continued to decline over the course of this year. Folks, I'm telling you that if you continue to hang around with your sin, eventually things that used to be comfortable, things that used to be enticing, turned you into a prisoner in a very dark place. And Jesus said, I'm setting you free. Jesus said, I'm healing you today. Jesus said, I'm changing your life, but you need to stop sinning and you need to come with me and you need to get out of this place that you're in. Folks, here I'm here to tell you today that Jesus will meet you in a rest stop at midnight if that's where you're at. Jesus will meet you at a pool by the sheep gate in the midst of the sick and lame if that's where you're at. Jesus will even meet you in the darkness of a prison cell if that's where you're at, because Jesus is here in the midst of your need. Whatever your need is, Jesus is here, and he has a divine encounter scheduled just for you. Will you let him in? Will you let his light shine in your darkness? Do you want to get well? So, guys, I saved prayer time until now. Because I believe God wants to touch your heart, and I want everybody to stand with me today. Lord, I thank you. You're so good. You're so good. We need you. Oh, we have great need for you, Lord. God, I pray for the needs in this box, but I also pray for the needs of every person here and all the people in our church who can't be here today. We need you. We need you for healing. We need you to touch our souls. We need you to give us a way out when it looks like there's no way out, Lord. need you, Jesus. Need you. Right now, I speak your grace into every person. I speak your healing. I speak your hope. I speak your provision. I speak the healing of hearts in Jesus' name. He's here today. He's standing right in front of you today to impart his grace into your life and to shine his light into the darkness of your soul. He's standing right here in front of you. Receive it. Receive it. Hallelujah. This past Friday, we came together. We had a good group of people here together who came not to be entertained, but who came to war before the throne of God on behalf of our loved ones who need Jesus. How many of you have loved ones who need Jesus? We came Friday to war on behalf of the loved ones who need Jesus. And I'm going to tell you something. The power of God showed up in this place on Friday. It was so powerful. We know that God's moving on our prayers. We know that he's moving in our lives. We know that he's moving on the hearts of our loved ones who need Jesus. So I'm going to give you, here's what we did. We came up and we wrote the names of our loved ones on this paper right here at the altar. We brought them to the altar and wrote their names down as we prayed over these people that we love so much who need Jesus. And I'm going to give you just a couple of minutes as the team plays. I want to give you just a couple of minutes that if you weren't here Friday and you have people in your life that you love who needs Jesus and you're praying for them, I want you to come up here and write their names on this paper, just symbolically that you're laying them on the altar before God. So I want you just to take a few minutes, and if that's you, I want you to come up and just write those names on this paper right now. We have several pens, you guys. You don't have to wait. You just go ahead and grab a pen and write names on there. Thank you. Why don't you stretch your hands toward these names up here. Lord God, in the name of Jesus, we pray for every person who's represented on this paper up here. We know that you love them even more than we do. So God, in the name of Jesus, we pray that you'll move upon their hearts, that you'll open their blind eyes, Lord God. We pray, Father, for the conviction of the Holy Spirit to come upon them and for them to see how much you love them, Lord God. We pray, Father, that you'll move their hearts, that you'll do whatever it takes, that you'll bring people into their path that they'll listen to, who will lead them to the knowledge of salvation, Lord God. We pray, God, whatever it takes, Lord, you know, God. We just pray on their behalf today and call out their names to you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Lift your hands to the Lord. I'm going to pronounce a priestly blessing over you today. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance and give you peace. Let's sing the song and you be blessed this week.